The greatest power you possess is your ability to choose. Join Lowe's Moore as he reveals how you can begin to maximize that power by exploring yourself on the deepest levels and committing to making lasting and positive changes. Get ready to achieve breakthroughs that will lead to accelerated growth and transformation, because you are now tuned in to The Blueprint.
Good evening and welcome back to Lowe's Moore and The Blueprint. I'm really excited to be back this week. And I want to say, thank you for all you guys' support of The Blueprint. I'm excited when I look at the numbers and see and the comments that I receive every week and the continuation of, you know, there'll be a number of individuals who will review or view the show tonight and then continue to do that as we go forward. And I hope that, like I said earlier, and when you hear the intro, it says the greatest power you have is the power of choice. And I thank you guys for choosing to come on The Blueprint every week and support it. And we hope that The Blueprint gives you the kind of information and revelation that will help you make confident and wise choices. And, you know, of course, you know, everybody, regardless of the pandemic, regardless of where you are, right, you should look up the word blueprint, right? And you know, many of us know that it has something to do with construction and building, and it is literally a visual plan of what you have in your mind. So, you know, everybody should have a blueprint. Everybody should have a vision. And I think scripturally it says that a people or a person without a vision, without a blueprint, without a plan will perish. And so make sure that you can take your dreams, your aspirations, and don't just leave them in your mind, put them down on paper. The scripture also says, write that vision down, line upon line, precept upon precept. And so do that, right? And I just want to get started with the rest of this show, because I'm really excited to have, you know, a good friend, friend and family member on The Blueprint tonight. I can't wait for him to come on. A few years ago, maybe about 2 years ago, I was sitting in my office at the Boys and Girls Club, and he walked in, man, and I hadn't seen him in so long. I just got so excited to see him. And this is going to be a great fellowship. This is going to be a great conversation. I hope you guys are blessed by it. And so let's move forward. And let me start with the book of the week. Right. I got my books of the week, books of the week, Gifted Hands, the Ben Carson story. I mean, I read this book some years ago, man. Dr. Carson was an awesome, still awesome surgeon. And, you know, I got a chance to meet him at a National Boys and Girls Club conference, man, and sit down and spend some time with them. And yeah, just one of those gifted men. Just an honor to sit down and have a conversation about his thoughts about young people. And you should read that story. I read that story. And is if you want to cheat, right, you can get the movie. You can just go on YouTube or something like that and just look at his story. I think Cuba Gooding Jr. plays him in the movie Gifted Hands. So make sure you get that, man. This is inspirational. And remember, I give you these books. You can choose your own books, but I give you books, right, because I think it's important to build a library. Everybody should have a library in their house of books, because that's how you grow when you read. And the other book of the week is Young, Gifted, and Black. I mean, this is another awesome book I think it's Teresa Perry, and she's a professor of African American Studies. And you should definitely get this book. And it was a song out by Donny Hathaway, Young, Gifted, and Black. Man, one of the more awesome songs. I think it's a song of legacy. When you hear that song, it's just something inspirational in that book. And then the word of the week, you heard me say it a few times, gifted, right? We are all gifted and we all have gifts. You heard me say many times on the show that God has given us, that we are all born with a purpose, right? And we're all born with gifts, and we all have gifts, right, for those purposes, right? And one of my gifts was to be an athlete. And you know, I used my gift to play professional basketball. So we all have gifts. And my guest tonight is gifted. And I'm excited to have him on the show. And so kind of built all this around, you know, Young, Gifted, and Black, Gifted Hands, Word of the Week, Gifted. And then for my Hill Harper, Pierce Harper affirmation and quote, right? And this is another quote, Bible verse. It says here, Proverbs 18:16, your gift will make room for you and bring you before great men. And I'll say great men and great women, right? It will bring you before your gift. What are your gifts? Identify what those gifts are. You have a core gift, and then you have a lot of other minor gifts, right? And find out what those gifts are. And so let me quickly remember the book of the week, the word of the week, and the affirmation of the week. And I want to give a shout out. I got a shout out here. Of course, last week I saluted the NBA, all those who made the Hall of Fame. And this week I salute Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And something the NBA did a couple of weeks ago was that they named an award after Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, the Kareem Abdul-Jabbar Social Justice Champion. That means at the end of every season, there's going to be an NBA player who stands for social justice who will win this award. And as you know, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar has stood for social justice for years, even when he was in college. And just an awesome man. I just have to say, man, when I first met Kareem, I was playing with the New Jersey Nets, and he was entering the hotel, and I was walking out the hotel. He was walking in the hotel. He literally had to bend down to go in the door, and I was like, wow. I was just in shock, man, to see Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, the former Lou Alcindor, the greatest high school player to ever play. Right. And some would say, man, if you would have put Michael Jordan, LeBron James, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, man, there could be just put them all on the mountain, you know, put all their heads on there and it'd be fine with me. They all great in their own right. So right now, man, I got a little highlight here before I introduce my guests, and we're gonna have a good time tonight.
My music is a reflection of my youth and of my connection to God. When I was quite young, my father passed away, and I feel my father's presence. I also feel the presence of my older brother who passed away when I was quite young. So I'm very, very connected to God through them. And also because of my experience singing gospel music, singing in the Black American church. This is a man's world.
World. But it wouldn't be nothing. Wouldn't be nothing. E o minune pentru cei cărora le predă. E deosebit de talentat și parcă divinitatea l-a trimis din state tocmai în Reșița.
Îți dai seama că în curând se va vorbi despre vestita școală de gospel din Reșița? Și eu doar la asta mă gândesc. Bă, mi se pare tare, mă. E ceva așa.
Being here with my students and being a part of this, and I'm more excited for them than I am for myself.
Din Bowman! Mulțumim copiilor de la școala de gospel din Reșița!
Din Bowman!
Nu-i vine să creadă!
Wow! That's my guest tonight, Dean Bowman, the great Dean Bowman. And you know, I put on the, you know, on my, I think it was the promo for tonight. You know, so I think it was, I said the voice of God, but I think it's Madonna who said a voice of a God.
Well, thank you very much, Lowe's. And you are a maestro, absolutely, and a superhero to me. And you always have been. That's a whole other story for later on. But actually, you know, the joke, I joke and tell people, well, actually, Madonna did not say I had the voice of a God. God said I have the voice of a Madonna. But anyway, that's just a joke.
That's awesome, man. So I want to thank you because I know it's 7:12 where I'm at. And it's right. 2:12 a.m. where you're at, right?
Yeah. That's why I'm in the kitchen right now, or in the front room right now while my wife sleeps. She's got to be at work in the morning.
So you're in a place.
We're in a flat in Reșița, Romania.
So
I have to be quiet. So you'll hear me talking down a little bit. Yeah. But it's a wonderful place to be, I tell you. When I was on the Romania Our Talent, and that's a whole other story. But when I was on Romania Our Talent, they asked me, I remember one of the crew guys asked me, he said, "You really don't want to compete, do you?" I said, "Not really, no." And so he was very nice. He said, "Well, don't see it as a competition, just see it as an opportunity to promote your school." And that's what I did. And so I was easily the oldest person in the competition. In fact, some of the competitors' parents are younger than me. And but I met some really talented young people. Just a joy. It was the greatest joy was to bring my students with me. And to participate in it. It was such a big deal for them. And it was they who encouraged me to do it. And that was what I said as the goal was to set the best example that I could for my students and for all of the young people associated with, because most of these people there were quite young. I met a talented young fellow named Radish Trufeo. Who Trufea, actually, my Romanian's not very good, but this cat is so talented. He's 17, and I mean, he has a beautiful Donny Hathaway thing on piano and vocals. He's so talented, and I told that young man, I said, "Look, man, you and I got to stay in touch. Cause I might have some work for you. I'm gonna call you, man. I'm gonna call you. You know, I might bring you to New York with me, and you know." And you can come to the hood and do what you do, man, you know.
Yeah.
So there's some talent out there, and it's a joy for me to be a part of it.
So I want to talk a little bit more about that, but I want to rewind a little bit and talk about, like, you know, a few things we have in common, like Mount Vernon High School, Southside Boys and Girls Club. I mean,
oh, yes.
So you were in school with my wife, and so talk to me a little bit about family and you know family, siblings growing up in Mount Vernon, and about education and also about faith.
I've said this before, you know, they always ask me, do you believe in God? No, I don't believe in God. I know God, and we're good. belief is for suckers. You know, I go out, I see the flowers and all like this, and I'm like, yeah, okay. I know I didn't do it. So, right. There's a power greater than me. And, and that's the thing. I'm very grateful for everything. I have family, and I've been blessed to have a very strong family and community support system, not only here, not only in Mount Vernon, but also it feels like it's everywhere that I've ever been. I've traveled a little bit. I haven't been everywhere, but I've been a lot of places, and I absolutely feel loved and welcomed. And that's, I think, a tribute to just being as much of a service as I can to whatever community I'm a part of. And that's something that I've learned. That's something I've had to learn to just be willing to risk it all, to be a part of it.
Right. So. Well, one of our last conversations I remember, right, in Mount Vernon at the Boys and Girls Club, and I think you were on your way talking about journalism, right, and talking about going to school. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so talk a little bit about that and then what happened, you know, after you leave college.
I wanted to sing, but I didn't really know what direction to take because I did not come out of a music school program. I had done some rudimentary stuff as far as learning a little bit of piano and learning a little bit about harmony in my college days. Being a part of the African American Arts Institute at Indiana University, my teacher, Professor James Mumford, may his soul rest in peace. He gave me tremendous confidence, and he encouraged me to pursue this. I did do the journalism thing. I did do the writing thing. I didn't pursue it as I should have because, again, it was more. I was passionate about it, but I wasn't as passionate about it as I was about music. So I pursued music. I joined an organization called the Black Rock Coalition in New York City. And at that point, I got introduced to some musicians who became my superheroes. People like Michael Hill, Ronnie Drayton, may his soul rest in peace. Jean-Paul Borelli. I remember a few years after I met Jean-Paul, he moved to Berlin. He lived in Berlin for, I think, 20 years. He might have moved back to the States. I'm not sure. But he has a daughter, Bibi Borelli, who is I don't know if you know about her, but she wrote a song and she had a little hit record a couple of years ago. I just became close to the Living Color crew, that whole crew, Vernon Reed, Will Calhoun, Corey Glover, who's a fantastic singer. Mm. I started studying with Corey's teacher, Greg Drew. And I began to really invest my heart and my soul into it. And then something happened in 1993 that kind of has to do with meeting Madonna. First thing, my older brother passed away. You remember him, and he, mm-hmm. And I told you this story. The very first time I ever walked into Mount Vernon High School basketball gym, I was 10 years old. I was with my big brother, and you and Carl Norton were his friends on the team. Yeah. So you guys were like my superheroes from age 10. And yeah. So wow. that was a big thing for me. And I guess I was 10 years old when I was like, wow, this is this is pretty amazing. We're pretty good at this. You know, it was like that, you know?
Right.
And I was really impressed with Carl Norton because he was also on the football team.
Yeah.
So, and he was a running back.
Yeah. And he was about 6'4".
Yeah. Yeah. You know, so he put it in. He got it in, man. He truly was a superhero. May his soul rest in peace.
Yeah.
And so a lot of those things all came together, and I had always been a singer. I sang when I started singing in front of people when I was 5 years old. So it wasn't any extension of who I was as much as it was a completion of who I was. Right around that time, early 90s, while I was with Black Rock Coalition, I got associated with a band called Screaming Headless Torsos. We did a record in 1995. I'm not throwing bricks at anybody by throwing out these years. I hope I hope I ain't making nobody mad.
Yeah, no, you're not.
At least I remember, right?
That's so, right.
Yeah, and then we released the record, and then I started playing with, again, superheroes. Don Byron, who is a legend. He's just a huge, huge influence. He is a tenor player. He is a clarinetist back then. He was only playing clarinet. I remember asking him back in those days. I said, Don, why don't you play, you know, saxophone or something like that? And Don was like, I'm a clarinetist, man. You know? And he gave me an education on the music of Duke Ellington.
Mm. Wow.
And that was, you know, I've learned so much about music just from his example. When we would be on the road, sometimes I'd wake up at 8 o'clock in the morning. And again, this is about preparation, because I always tell my students, prepare for greatness. I wake up in the morning, 7, 8 o'clock in the morning, and I hear Don on the tenor saxophone playing Bach.
Wow.
So, as he calls him, Johann Sebastian Bach. yeah, he's a phenomenon. And you know, his greatness is it precedes him. I also played with Lester Bowie, may his soul rest in peace, Jack Walrath. And then I rejoined the Screamings, and then I was with them for about 2 years, and I got a call from John Scofield. Mm. So I went out with Scofield for about a year. And, you know, there was at one point we had played. I remember this was a real education. This is when you find out. It's just like with sports, when you have, like, you know, I guess if you play like, I mean, especially on a high level, when you play like, you know, 5 games in 7 or 8 days, you know, and you know, that's when you really find out, do you want this, you know? When we had played, at one point we played 39 concerts in 42 nights, or something really crazy. And this was the music of Ray Charles. Hmm. I did not know how hard the music of Ray Charles was to sing. Wow. I did not know, because it's one thing to listen to it, it's something else to sing it yourself. And you have to be Ray. You have to bring them to Ray. And I found out that Ray Charles is the joint everywhere.
Wow.
Everywhere. Everybody loves Ray Charles. Mm-hmm. So, and I think we did the tour the year the film, the Jamie Foxx film came out. Yeah. So, yeah. So I toured with Scofield for most of a year. That was 2005 or six, something like that. And through that connection, and this brings me to Romania, through that connection, I've got a call to bring my band to Romania. And I took Tony Cintron, Mount Vernon.
Oh, yeah. Tony.
And also I took Rael Wesley Grant, who's my music teacher, And I took Dee Dee Jackson as well. And that, and we did a tour of three cities, Sibiu, Brasov, and Ploiești. And we did that. That was my first time in Romania. And I dug Romania. I was, you know, it was very, you know, beautiful, stunningly beautiful. The gorge, the sea, the mountains in the north and the west. And I've told you about the monasteries. There's hundreds and hundreds of monasteries that are just incredible. They've been there for, you know, maybe 1,000 years, some of them. So it's and, you know, I've always been kind of a history, you know, person. In fact, my degree is in history. So this was a perfect storm. I'm grateful to my mom and my dad, may his soul rest in peace, because they are me. My mom has a terrible singing voice, and she's charismatic and doesn't care who likes her singing or not. She'll sing in front of anybody. My father had a beautiful singing voice. I'm told that, you know, he was better than me, and I'll take that. You know, in fact, when I was talking to Robbie Coltrane, you know, because Robbie takes a lot of heat for being the son of John Coltrane. And I said, man, Robbie, man, don't worry about that, man. I said, my father was better than me, too. Now, my father wasn't John Coltrane, but still, you know.
Right.
Don't worry about it. Just do you, man. Just do you. If your father was alive, he'd be talking about you.
Yeah. Hey, let me throw out a couple of, you know, you know, remember, this is interactive. So if you guys got any questions or anything like that, please don't hesitate to put them up. We can see them. And let me, you know, each week I talk about nuggets or dimes, right? You know, I just always say that my grandfather said, come here, boy, I want to give you a nugget. And I was thinking, like, looking at his hand for something, you know, and but it was nothing there. But he was giving me some information, or he's giving me something that was important. Or Damon Lillard played in a commercial, the insurance commercial about dropping dimes, right? And so you dropped a nugget and a dime a few times already. Like you said, right, that you got up early in the morning, right? And so as I explained, the gift, the word of the week is a gift, but a gift has to be nurtured. Right. And then whether or not you love that gift or have some passion, you would spend a lot of time doing it, you know, getting up early in the morning to go to the playground to shoot baskets, to get in the gym early. I mean, to shovel the snow. So you drop something like getting up early, you know, getting it going. I mean, I think that's very, very powerful. And that's a nugget that people say. And you also said, right, something about the passion or the love for something, right, that you were willing, you know, when you have a love of passion, some people say you shouldn't do that. You know, like there are a lot of people who grow up and say, look, I want you to get a good education, man. I want you to get a college degree. And but yet your love for something is not in that. Your love for something is in the music or the acting. Right. And so you putting in the, you like, okay, well, I'm going to sacrifice because I love this. Right. And I'm willing to put the passion and the energy into it to make this thing happen, no matter what somebody says to me. So, yeah, I mean, so talk a little bit more about, you know, that as you go along, because you look, you're talking about Romania, you're talking about all these countries. So now look where that gift has taken you.
It's a blessing, you know, just to travel. And this was funny. We were talking about this today. Now I got a call, I guess it was about 2 weeks ago, from Hamid Drake, who is a drummer, friend of mine, amazing musician. And he called me, and we couldn't connect, but he tried me again. It was yesterday. And we spoke about, we're doing a gig in Sardinia.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to Sardinia in the end of July. Not my first time. I was there a few years ago with Don Byron, actually.
Right.
What's up, cuzzo? Cousin Mike.
Cousin Mike.
Yeah.
A little quick guess for you, man.
Yeah.
Keep talking.
So, Yeah, when I went to we're going to Sardinia, but I promise my wife and my stepdaughter we have to do Venice when they open back up again. We got to go to Venice.
Got to go to Venice.
I was in Venice last time. I did a workshop there. I did a teaching gig there. This is about 3 years ago, and I've been trying to get back ever since. But I'm gonna bring the girls there. Bring the girls to Venice, and we'll do Venice. We'll do Venice good. But you know, funny thing is, like, you know, the historian in me, Venice is. Venice is not Europe. Venice is outside of the EU. It is a separate country unto itself, and it's not in the EU. So and that brings me to some other stuff. I have a book. I have a book to offer. I encourage the listeners to check out this book. I think I posted it.
Okay.
The book is The History of Black Business in America. Hey, what's up, fam? What's up?
Say hi.
What's up, fam? I got a book for you.
I'm ready to read.
The History of Black Business in America by Julia E.K. Walker. It's one of the most interesting, fascinating, positive, and constructive books that anybody should read. I mean, we should definitely read books like this. One of the things is we get down on ourselves thinking that we can't do anything or that we're not doing anything. Man, we've been doing it since before slavery time. Check out a cat named Free Frank. Check out a cat named Free Frank. Juliet Walker wrote a book about him. Free Frank was, yes, exactly. Thanks, cuz. Definitely. But check out a cat named Free Frank, because this was a black entrepreneur during slavery. I mean, and if I recall the story correctly, he bought freedom for all of his family and for close friends. He had bought freedom using his skills as an entrepreneur, you know? Because, you know, we always say to ourselves, well, when are we going to get ourselves together? We've been getting ourselves together for hundreds of years. You know, and you'll find out when you read that book, you'll find out what keeps happening. Same thing keeps happening to us. You know, we have to at some point make a choice between trying to make it in a system that is set up to conquer us, or just acquiescing to the system and trying to do the best that we can within that system, because it's usually one of five things that happen to you. I want to keep it positive, but you should read the book just to see it for yourself.
Right.
What I encourage my students, I give this to my students. I tell them this. I tell them things like, prepare yourself for greatness. When I went out with Schofield, I learned that 15 minutes early is on time. I would show up for lobby calls 15 minutes early and everybody be there already.
Wow.
You know, so 15 minutes early is on time. And it also, and particularly when you're traveling, and this is even if you're not an athlete, it don't hurt, especially when you're in a hotel that has a gym, go to the gym. just get in there. Just go in the gym. Go there first thing in the morning before you hit breakfast. I'm going to tell you right now, because it makes your brain work better. It makes your brain work better. You can do 15 minutes on the treadmill. I remember I had a gig at a gym. There was a trainer in there, and they said, hey, man, you can do a free workout. No problem. I went in there. I said, okay, look, I only got 15 minutes. I said, fine. Put me on a treadmill for 15 minutes.
Mm.
He emptied the tank, man. He emptied my tank completely. He emptied my tank. I said, okay, all right. I have no excuse. If Muggsy Bogues at 5'3" can play in the NBA for 14 years, nobody can make an excuse. You can't make no excuses, man.
Oh yeah, I was just talking to somebody earlier today, saying like I was talking to my son. I was like, man, my coach, I was like 11 years old, right? And you know, my first basketball team with Mr. Jones at the board. And he said to me, man, if you get here 30 minutes before practice, you late.
Right? Ooh.
And I was like, man, you know, so you learn to be. I've learned like now, my first goal is to be there an hour before it happens. Right? Because you know it's gonna happen. My whole goal is get to the place an hour before it happens. If I tell my kids practice workout is at 6 o'clock in the morning, I'm there at 5.
Mm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So man, you are absolutely right, man. And then the other thing about we were talking about earlier. And you were talking to your students about in regards to teaching music, and you were talking about basketball, you know, and
basketball,
the impact that basketball has. So talk a little bit about when you're talking about that type of training.
Basketball, I was talking to Cornbread about this. I said to him, you know, I use basketball to teach singing. And he said, well, why not? It's what you know. But you know, to get your singers in a nice layup line, you know, and you know, we're not going to be George Gervin and Michael Jordan and all of this. It's not about that. You know, you don't practice the piano with the hope that you'll be Herbie Hancock. You practice the piano to help you with your skill, with your focus. You know, and also it's to master yourself. I said this to my son. I said, master those things that are boring. You know, learn to master the mundane, you know. Yeah, it's boring, but you can find, you know, entertainment in the most mundane things. So I use basketball. I say just do 100 dribbles with each hand. You know, just 100 dribbles with each hand, 100 dribbles with your left hand, 100 dribbles with your right hand. Yeah, you can look at the ball. Yeah, you know, you can. You know, you can't, you know, I'm not expecting you to hold your head up and be Penny Hardaway, you know, but yeah, just to get that concentration. And I mentioned this before, which was about an article I read in the New York Times about, is there such a thing as a hot hand? Well, yeah, it's called muscle memory, you know. You know, when you do something repeatedly, you know, it's just like when I do the long tone, I practice the long tone, and I do that with my students, and I tell them, you know, just practice, like, we'll just sing B flat for like 15 minutes. Mm. Just hold B flat as long as you can for 15 minutes and sing it pianissimo, and then crescendo it sometimes, decrescendo. And just do that. And just really climb into B flat, and then we'll do G for a few minutes, and then we'll do C sharp for a few minutes. And you learn to identify where the notes are inside your own body. And that's where your muscle memory comes from as far as singing and internalizing the sound. You can create different sounds with the same note. And all like this, this becomes your ritual. And it's also very zen to sing the same note. It's also harder to sing the same note than it is to change notes all the time.
Right.
To just hold one note. You know, you have to breathe, but then you repeat, you know, and to stay on the same note. It requires a lot of concentration. But it also requires you to relax your mind, especially when you sing it really softly. It's more intense, you know. It's just like when you scream and yell at somebody, like at your child or something like that. They look at you like you're crazy. But if you whisper it softly, then it's a completely different impact. But it also they're able to retain it in a different way from when it's just emotion, you know. But yeah, I use basketball as a tool, you know, as a tool of it's a fun game. I said to Cornbread, I said, it's an easy game to play. It's just a hard game to play well. You know, it's one thing to put the ball into the basket, but it's something else to put the ball into the basket. You got LeBron James elbowing you in the mouth, you know.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, what's interesting is that over the last few years, you know, I've been checking you out on YouTube and following you. And
thank you.
Man, so many different, how do you do it? So many different types of styles of music, from jazz to gospel. I mean, I've seen you sing so many different things. And man, the one of my favorites, somebody might not think it would be my favorite, but Screamin' Hendrix.
Screamin' Hendrix, yes. That was a group, those are my Italian cats. I have an Italian crew. I actually have a couple of Italian bands. I'm going to Sardinia with one of them. That crew, although they have broke up, one of the guys, oh yeah, this is another thing. You know, these cats are based in Sapri. Sapri, mm-hmm. Policastro, there's the Gulf of Policastro on the, I guess, okay, it's about 2 hours south of Salerno, which is about 2 hours south of Napoli and Naples. And Naples is about 2 hours south of Rome. So it's in Campania. And Sapri Policastro is gorgeous. It's just beautiful, you know. It's right on the Gulf of Policastro in on the west coast, in the Mediterranean. And you know, it doesn't suck. It's kind of nice. I've toured with them all over Southern Italy. Over Southern Italy, I've toured with those kids. In fact, I got pictures of us driving in the car all over Southern Italy, playing, you know, little clubs, and we played a festival or two. And yeah, those cats are great. But one of them, they broke up because one of them moved to Venice. Actually, one of them moved to Venice. He moved to Bologna, which is near Venice. And the other two, they're still down in Sapri. So yeah, but Italy was hard hit by the pandemic. So I had to, in fact, interestingly enough, when they closed Italy in February of last year, I had a tour in February of last year that they canceled the month before. If I had gone on that tour, I would have been right in the thick of it when people were, you know, we were losing a lot of people. I would have been right there during that. I might not have been able to get back to Romania.
Right.
But and by the way, just for the record, I'm not LeBron. I'll just tell you straight up. I got the vaccine. I didn't want to, but I got the Johnson & Johnson one, the one shot deal. So I said, okay, let me just do this. I said, checkmate. Y'all got me. Cause I have to work, and I have to go visit my children and stuff like that. I have to go to Denmark. My children are in Denmark.
Okay.
And I got to travel. In fact, my son, he just came back from Denmark. He's in what you call, I don't know if it's isolation or quarantine, but they won't let him back in school until the 4th of June. So he's at home. I try to call him every day, make sure that, you know, he's not too stir crazy. You've seen pictures of my son. He is a ladies man. He's always been a ladies' man. I mean, God, the girls in my chorus, they just love him. They just love him. He's a little bit wild, but he'll be 10 in September, so he'll calm down eventually.
So in these travels and with the music and travel and languages, talk a little bit about languages, man. I mean,
okay, now I'm going to have to go back to basketball. because, well, you know, the saying is the international language of basketball is English. Mm-hmm. Well, you're a basketball player, so you know that's not true. The international language of basketball is eye contact. It's the same thing when you're traveling. You have to make eye contact because they ain't gonna understand you anyway. So you know what I'm saying? So get a few phrases, get some eye contact going on, and yeah, you'll be okay. But my Romanian isn't what it should be after 5 years here, but I do try. My son is starting to pick up on it as well. But I am improving. Fiecare zi, puțin mai puțin. I get better, a little bit better every day, little by little, puțin mai puțin. Fiecare zi. And in fact, I learned a Romanian song, which a bunch of us were hanging out after the composition, and we sang all of these Romanian songs outside the hotel before the police came out and said, y'all got to go, y'all keeping us up. Oh, and by the way, you mentioned being an hour early. Well, in Bucharest, you have to be an hour early because that place is crazy. That place is crazy. It makes New York City traffic look like, you know, look like nothing. It's crazy. It's crazy. One of the reasons why I don't particularly want to learn Romanian, in fact, is because of the language that the people use on the cars when they're driving through Bucharest, man. It is the swear words. The swear words are just over the top. They're over the top. My wife says some things that I'm like, honey, you don't curse. Shut up. But Romania is a beautiful place. And you know, but again, language is, it really is about communication and learning. And because we're all trying to learn. A lot of the children here are trying to learn English. So most of my students, they don't speak English. In fact, one of my students, we call him Google Translate. Yeah, the little guy on the lower left hand side. That's Google Translate.
Okay. Yeah.
He's a brilliant young fellow. But yeah, I'm really blessed. My students are they complete my time here. They complete me here. You know. They are my family.
Yeah. And so, I mean, so you have a school, what are you doing? You have a school there, a music school or.
Yeah. My wife is the first person to ever tell me that I could start a music school. She said, you could start a music school. I said, oh, come on. And she was serious. And I did. And, it's volunteer. I do get some logistical support from the city, and I apply for grants. My wife helps me apply for grants, and in order to keep the school going, and I also have some income, some basic income for the teaching that comes through one of the local schools here in the city. I also teach. Music, well, not really teach music. I just basically sing, and I encourage the children to sing along. Special needs, children with special needs, which I really can't say too much about because I think it's that there's something about like this, like it's supposed to go up to age 18, but I'm sure that not all of those people are. Oh, I'm sure some of them are over 18.
Right.
You know, and unfortunately, and this is why it has to be kept quiet, is like once they turn 18, they're supposed to put them out in the street. Mm. But the person who runs the thing, she's not going to do that. She's just not going to do that. She's right. Not going to put them out in the street, you know. So we kind of keep it quiet, you know. But yeah, There's some people in there. There's some grown people in there, but because they're not ready to be out in the street. They're not ready to try to make it. They're barely functioning. They need help.
Right.
Okay. So you can't just put them out there, you know? Right. So I go there once a week and I sing, usually I sing the same song, you know, the same couple of songs for them. And we do our, I guess that's kind of the service that I provide. Again, this is about being of service to the community. You know, that's really all it's about, being of service. That's why you're here. You know, you have business to take care of, and that business is to be of service to your community. Even if it don't pay you, that's something else. One of my musician friends, Kelvin Bell, he tells me all the time, it's like, you know, well, I ask, well, how much is the gig paying? It's like, well, you know, if it ain't enough money, add something to it. You know, sell a record. You know, sell some merch. You know, I mean, you got to do what you got to do. You have to remain before the public.
Right.
You know, Louis Armstrong said it. Betty Carter said it. You know, you must remain before the public, because we ain't Mick Jagger and we ain't Lenny Kravitz, you know, and our records being played on the radio and we can get huge checks every 13 weeks.
Right.
You know, so we have to remain before the public, you know.
Yeah.
And that's our thing. That's our thing.
Yeah. So talk a little bit about, regards to, because one of the things that the arts, I'm sure during the pandemic have struggled, like theater, but
yeah,
music. And we, Therese and I knew, it was a gentleman and we had met, and he owned a restaurant. I met him and we went to the restaurant down in the Bronx. Wonderful restaurant. And he had a number of individuals that he was on the board for music, and he was really passionate about the blues and jazz, and he was always raising money and trying to. He had a foundation, and they were raising money to, you know, provide for those artists. Those, because we just don't support, you know, the music industry. And I think I was talking to Mike Phillips. You know Mike Phillips from Mount Vernon?
I'm sure I do.
He plays the saxophone. I had him on the podcast, man. But he's from Mount Vernon. He went to Mount Vernon High School, graduated, and went to the Boys and Girls Club. And man, he's awesome. A lot of times you'll see him at football games. He's playing the national anthem with his sax. And so we were talking about this in regards to how do we get people to support the arts, music in particular, you know, and all these artists out there that they're not getting paid. I mean, you should be getting paid, definitely.
You know, in fact, here's one of the hardest things about it, because I got a grant from the United States Embassy to do some online clinics. One of the online clinics was an attorney in New York named Kerwin Sims. And I did an interview with him, and he was gracious, just wonderful, very, very informative. And that's a big problem. And it's not just for the young people. It's people who've been in the business for 20, 30 years who just don't even know what they don't know. That's the big problem, because there's so many different portals that the music goes out through that we're not aware of, that we get lost in it. And some people just say, well, the heck with it. I'm just going to just focus on my music, and I'm not going to worry about the business and let the business take care of itself. But it's like, if you don't handle the business is going to handle you. So yeah, you have to at least be aware of some of the things that are available to you. I also say that for people who can contribute, check out the Jazz Foundation of America. They helped me out a few times. The Jazz Foundation of America, I think the Rhythm and Blues Foundation is another one.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there's that. And really the thing is also to support the arts. You know, when I went out with Schofield, this was something that I learned. Those of us who can, like, people have been downloading music for free, you know, and all like that. And I'm kind of in the middle of it because I'm an artist. So consider that a record, to buy the new hit record was about a dollar 50 years ago, and it's a dollar still today.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Tony Cintron and I were talking about this one time, and think in your mind, 1991 in New York City, if you had a gig, if it paid you $50 or $100, okay, you know. If it paid you $200 or $300, that's a little better. If it pays you $500, it's a good gig. If it pays you $1,000, it's a very good gig. It's the same thing today, 30 years later.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah. So learn your lesson, which is these, I guess, four or five words, whatever the market will bear. People are going to download. People are going to listen on YouTube. People are going to listen on the radio. It's just that there has to be some kind of mechanism where, I mean, at least buy a couple records, buy some records, you know what I'm saying, and support the artists. Horace Silver was, you know, phenomenal artist. Some of y'all know about Horace Silver. And, you know, he would do a gig somewhere and somebody would come up to him after the show. Oh, Maestro, where can we get your record? He goes, I got him right here.
Yeah, true. Yeah.
I got him right here. You can get him right here, right now, you know? So, you know, that's something that I do. I make sure that I have, whenever I play somewhere, in fact, my wife, she's better at that than I am. She's an attorney, so she's up on it.
Right.
She makes sure a few CDs, you know, to supplement whatever it is that I'm getting paid, make sure to bring a few CDs with me. In fact, I mentioned to my wife today, I said, you know what? Now's the time to do another record.
Yeah. So that's a good
one. I tried to do a Christmas record. In fact, I was working on, I wanted to do a record, a Christmas song. Cause you know, you checked me out for my Christmas concert online.
Yeah. Yeah.
At that point I wanted to do a Christmas record, but we couldn't finish it in time. Cause there's some local cats here, Christy Jakob, good friend. What's up, Christy? And he's a beautiful friend of mine. Plays all instruments. His dad played all instruments as well. His dad's a drummer, and he's a guitar player. He plays good drums, plays very good drums, and plays all instruments. But he's a guitar player and a singer, and he plays all that Romanian stuff. He's really soulful. He tears that Romanian stuff up.
Yeah.
So yeah, but he and I were working on a Christmas record, but then he had to leave. He had to leave the country because, I mean, it's hard. It's rough. He had to leave the country. He went to Switzerland and, did some busking and some construction work there. So yeah, you know, it's rough in Romania, you know? Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm going to definitely, that's something we discussed. I'm going to definitely do a record, this year. I want to definitely do another one this year. I did my last record here in town here in Romania about 2 years ago, and I'm going to do another one, I think, this year, because this would be the time to do it.
Well, yeah, you should let you got, okay, these are just some business questions. You got to You got a website?
Bring it on. Bring it on. I do have a website, visionsofdreams.ro. Visions of Dreams. In fact, let me bring it up just to make sure that it is here. Visions-of-dreams.ro. I'll post it in the chat.
And you have your music on there that people can purchase?
I don't have the music on there for purchase, but I'm gonna get that together. I haven't been up on it. You know, I put that in my chat. People don't plan to fail; they fail to plan.
Yeah.
So that's something I'm gonna get that together. And I do have my solo a cappella gospel record. That one's on. I'm sure you can buy that one on Amazon. Do what you can.
Putting up some stuff now, and we want to know. We want to follow you. We want to we want to get your songs.
And also, like I said, you can also donate to my school. Right now, I'm completely volunteer. And, the children don't pay me a dime, which is fine because, you know, I've said this before, I get more from them than they get from me.
Right.
They are a huge part of what I do. So, I do have links on my Facebook page, for people who can donate. You can donate on PayPal. You can donate on Revolut. I accept Bitcoin. I don't know what it is, but I'll accept it. Sure. Bring it on. Sure.
So we got to make sure you know, we get good. You here. Let's go back in a little bit of history because I was listening to some individuals talk about your support of the women's basketball team back in Mount Vernon growing up and being on the bus and singing on the bus. Man, I want to pop on some guests here. Let's see if we can pop them on and see.
Hi there, sweetie.
How are you, my love?
I am good. I see you are good.
You know the devil can't guard me. Devil never could guard me. They only hope the shots aren't falling. That's all. That's all that is.
But I'm
how have you been?
I love you. I'm so proud to hear the good things about you. I got a few things. Look, you talk about basketball.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yes, 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 yes.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
You was there.
I was there. I wish we could stay young forever. Well, actually, we can. We can.
I got something for you. Look at this. I don't know if you can see that. That's the Mount Vernon basketball gym, high school gym, part of the floor.
Put that on. That's right. That's right.
But you talk about you singing. Remember, you used to always sing on the bus, always singing.
It's life. It's just like basketball. I said to Lowe's, I said, you know, singing is like basketball. You know, when you put the ball up to the basket, it's probably not going to go in. Singing's like that, too.
And do you remember Bucky Smith, William Bucky Smith?
Of course I remember.
Yes, Bucky. I showed him the podcast. I showed him the singing Tree sent to me, and he wishes you well. He was like, look, Dean.
Bucky, man.
You know.
That's our brother, always.
Yes, yes. He's doing always. Well and sends his regards. So good seeing you.
God bless Bucky. So and God bless you.
Same here, my brother. You know, we always family.
Y'all freeze.
Mm-hmm. This is glorious. This is glorious. This is
yeah.
Yeah, I'm just overwhelmed. I really am. And it's, you know, it's like we ain't never left, because everywhere we go, I mean, I bring Mr. Paxson with me. I bring, you know, I bring Tony Ferrantino with me, you know. Even though he wasn't my coach, you know, but I learned a lot of lessons from him just being in the room with him. And you know, I learn, you know, I'm still learning, and I'm still, you know, giving and sharing, because, you know, I'm kind of a disciple of Reverend Ike. Reverend Ike say, you don't have to have money. You can give praise, you can give thanks, you know, anybody can give. Ricky Burton.
Legend, what's up?
What's up? One of my tenors.
There you go, brother. Come on now. Mm-mm-mm. You know, I thought I was Teddy Pendergrass.
You were, Ricky.
You still are.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. My wife don't think I can sing. I said, you have no idea, girl. You have no clue. He has no idea.
Not a clue.
My kids say, why do you sing so much? I can't help it.
Can't help it. Yeah. Have to.
What's going on, people?
Yeah, good. You got Trees here. Yeah. You got
Ricky. My God. I used to sing to Trees every day.
I'll tell you what, I was telling Lowe's, I said, there was nothing like being on the bus with Ricky on there, Dean on there, Leslie. I mean, we had our own gospel choir, you know, going there, right? White Plains, and the guys.
You guys are the superheroes, because y'all play basketball, okay? You know, anybody can sing, not anybody can play basketball.
Well, that's not true. Lowe's can't.
Definitely not true.
Oh my God.
Class of 81. I mean, we had a great class.
Class of 81.
We had the best class ever.
Yes.
Yep. We are the best class ever. There's no question.
And we didn't lose any games, so it made the bus ride kind of easy.
Right.
That year was a totally undefeated year. Nobody lost.
Yeah. So,
but if I recall correctly, and I remember this too, I think in my entire high school life, I think I've seen about two losses in basketball. I mean, in like my whole life, I like two. I mean, out of 100 games that I've seen in my, like two. And we didn't play scrubs. I remember we played against Ed Pinckney, who played in the NBA for 15 years. Yep. He was a really good ball player.
Yeah.
One of the teams that we lost to, I think it was Ted Shirley's team. Maybe we lost to them, Greenberg or something like that. I don't remember that. But we played against not Elton Brand. He was after us. But who was somebody else from that team?
Did you play Chris Mullin?
No, yes. We didn't play against Chris Mullin.
We played them. We played them in the Federation.
Oh, okay. Severian.
Yeah, they beat us by 2 points.
Right. Yeah. And there was another one, but there was some NBA. We played against some NBA guys that were okay. Now I got to tell you a Prince story.
Okay.
My friend Will Calhoun, he's the drummer for Living Color. What a lot of people do not know was that he was also a very good point guard out of Tallentine High School back in the day. Well, Prince did not know that when he challenged him to a one-on-one.
Prince the singer? Prince?
Rest in peace. Prince didn't know that. And Will lit him up, and Prince got mad.
What did he do?
He lit him up, and Prince got mad.
Did you get a chance to perform with him?
There's a lot of people I haven't met. I never met Prince, but that was just an interesting story of somebody I know personally. But yeah, Will told me that story. But basketball is, you know, you never forget. You never forget what it really means. I went to school in Indiana, and I also lived in Serbia for a couple of years. That's where Drazen Petrovic is from. You played against Drazen, didn't you, Rick?
I did several times. Yeah.
Yeah. So, remember, Draz was no joke. Oh, this brings me to another one. Lois, I meant to ask you this. My all-time woulda, coulda, shoulda team. Now, my all-time favorite basketball team on any level was class of 81, my high school team, the boys and the girls, greatest team. That was my all-time favorite team. And I saw Steve Alford in high school. All right. Steve Alford, I saw him score 57 points and barely break a sweat in the semi-state the year before he came to Indiana. So he could play. But my all-time woulda, coulda, shoulda is I got Sugar at the point, Mahmoud at the two, but I'm torn at the three. Reggie Lewis or Drazen Petrovic? Who you got at the three? At the four and the five, I got Len Bias and Roy Tarpley.
Where's Lowe's at, man? What are you talking about? Where's Lowe's at?
No, but he can't be on the team because he played in the NBA for 14 years. So you can't put him on that team.
If Lowe's is playing in this generation, he'd be making $30 million a year right now.
If he was playing in this generation, there's no doubt he would be a mid-level exception for 15, 20 million, no doubt. Wow.
Easy.
Easy.
That's a hard question.
Hard one between Reggie Lewis and Drazen Petrovic, especially in this era with 3-and-D. Because if Mike was playing in this era, he's 50 a game.
Well, let me say this, that when you look at Reggie Lewis, I would say his athleticism and his intellect made him such a great player. I mean, Drazen wasn't as athletic, but he was
tough.
And heart for the game, man. I mean, he would fight you in an alley, you know, just to win.
Drazen's ball handling was a little bit, not dribbling, his ball handling. Yeah. And I think there's a difference. I think a lot of people get dribbling and ball handling confused.
I don't think you can go wrong with whoever you choose.
That's a good team, though. That's a good team.
A lot of people that are watching. Some of the young folks probably say, who are these people? Who are these people? Roy Tarpley? Who's Roy Tarpley?
Roy Tarpley, man. I saw him in Michigan. I saw him when he was at Michigan. I was at IU. He was dominating.
Yeah, but no.
Or Uwe Blah.
I would take Rick Burton over him because he stopped Patrick Ewing. I would just, you know.
we used to experience Dean, and I think once you went off the college, I'm not sure whether or not you got a chance to really enjoy as much of the Greenberg experience, because as much as the Mount Vernon High School games were great, the 4th Street Playground and the Greenberg, and, you know, we didn't get that today, get back in the day. Back in the day, you know, the guys would play their NBA games, and then when the season would end, they'd be in 4th Street Playground. And there would be people climbing up on the fence at the top of the fence, trees, you know, if when Milbank came and played against
Milbank,
it would be unbelievable the amount of people, you know. But we here also to continue to talk about your singing career. And, you know, when I think about, like I said, for me, there was nothing more enjoyable than to hear you, Les, and Rick, you know, below. And what I loved about it was, there was never a time that we would say, all right, come on, sing. That one of y'all would go, man, I'm so tired of singing. Like, why y'all always ask me to sing? It was like, when we said sing, and y'all couldn't get the words out, the song out. You know, because some folks can sing, right? And then when you ask them to sing, they're like, they get all attitude-y, like, about singing. Like, for those of us who don't sing, like y'all sing, we can't wait. We're like sitting there, like sitting on the edge of our seats, go, what they gonna sing next? We never had to ask y'all to sing. I can ask Les to sing something right now. Les, go right.
I love to sing, and again, it really is. And this is why I pursued it. You know, when my big brother passed away, I realized because I was 29, and he was 35. And it was like, okay, well, I guess this is the, I guess that's what this is life. This is life, man. You know, it's too short. Yeah. Might as well keep it. Might as well do this. And I'm gonna burn my bridges behind me. And things have worked out. Hey, Didi, what's up?
Yeah, we see Didi down there, and yeah, this is awesome, man. Hey, Rick, your wife is listening.
Yeah, she's listening.
Yeah. Hey, Rick had skills.
Rick with the high school, our high school. You know who was in gospel choir with us, Patrice? Who's that? And Lowe's, Kirby George.
Oh yeah, I remember Kirby. Yeah,
he was in gospel choir. He was in gospel choir with us.
His brother's married to Lowe's assistant.
Right. Exactly. Kirby was another. In fact, Kirby was about the only three sport athlete I knew. And most guys played one. Most girls, they play one, maybe two. Some of them play two. Kirby's like the only three sport athlete I ever knew. He played baseball, basketball, and football.
I think Wiley Grady did too.
Oh yeah, he played basketball too.
Yeah, but I don't think Wiley made it to varsity. I know he played JV, and then he played baseball and he played football.
Well, Wiley was cleanup hitter, left handed cleanup hitter. Mm-hmm. Haywood was right handed cleanup hitter.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know what I want you to do for Dean, because I did it for, well, I was talking about Mike Phillips, and earlier, about maybe 2 or 3 months ago, during the pandemic, he had a show. I'm sure there was people in the crowd, but when he did the show, he put it out to us, and I think it was a certain amount of money to stream it. You know, you had to pay. Mm-hmm. Right, you should do something where we can, you know, where we can support you, and where we can support the kids at the school.
I definitely will. I'm going to put that together. I have not been, for these last weeks, I've just been focused on Romania Old Talent, trying to get because I. The thing is, like, and I told you this, I had no illusions about winning, but I insisted that I bring my students. I mean, they wanted me to sing. It was my students who told me to do it because I didn't want to do it. You know, this isn't for me. It's for people just starting out, you know. And I would not to say that I'm too good for it, because I'm certainly not too good to be seen by millions of people. But I wanted my students to be a part of it. I mean, that's you know, that was the thing. So, when we did Purple Rain, I brought 16 of my students. And then when we qualified, and you saw how shocked I was that I made it to the finals. I thought my work was done here, man. He's like, I got my students on TV. I'm good, you know. And then, oh, you're in the finals, huh? I was planning to go to the sea with the wife, man. And they said, no, you got to stay. You got to stay for the following week. So we did.
Tony J. They're like, please put something together.
That can be
next extreme. I'm gonna do this. I promise you, I'm gonna do this. I have not been focused on this, because like everything changed all of a sudden. Now all of a sudden I'm a celebrity here, man. It's like,
now you sing, right? And a lot of times when people are gifted or talented in something, they pass those gifts or talents down to their children, right? So Rick, I know Rick sings. Rank sing, but Rick was also an athlete, and his sons are athletes. His sons are athletes, and I'm not sure if your daughter is, but I know your sons were athletes, Rick. Do you have singing? Is your kids have a singing talent in them?
That's funny. Rick, go ahead, Rick. No, I was going to say it's funny because we have singing in my house all the time.
Right.
So we just had it a couple of days ago, actually. So I make my kids sing gospel music.
Yeah,
my 11-year-old is in love with Luther Vandross right now, so they gotta sing old school stuff, because I don't want to hear all the new rap. We want to hear some old school. So
you have six kids, seven.
I have six, and we definitely have it in my house. You must sing.
The choir.
That's must. Right. We have all parts too, huh, Rick?
That's it. Gospel, everything. Yes, and gospel. That's
right. Right. All the parts.
Got to do it. You got to do it.
That's so awesome.
So, Dean, can your son sing?
Son and daughter sing?
Okay. Here's. Okay, I'm gonna have to do it quietly because it's 3 o'clock in the morning here in Romania, and I don't want to wake the wife. She's got to go to work in the morning. Somebody's got to work it. But, let me just think of one. I have to come to. Okay.
Uh-oh.
I told this young boy. I told you about him. His name is Radis Trufea, 17, and he sings the old Romanian stuff. He sings it beautifully, all right? But he also found time to learn some, to learn some of the, the classics. I was sound checking one time, and I just started breaking out into, I've been so many places in my life and times. You know, I broke into that one, and the cat just fell right in, man. I was like, what? How do you know that song? You ain't but 17, man. And he was playing that, and he was playing the Bach and all of that. But I'm going to sing a Romanian song for y'all. I'm going to see if I can get this together because, because he I promised myself, and I need the lyrics because my pronunciation isn't so good, but I'm going to do my best. La cucima din cartier. Unde se conto si se bea, fra asta sera supertrec, cu amintie din viața mea, am mai făcut cu ți-o betie, am mai iubit niște femei, și m-am vândut la galerie, pentru un bilet de cut vale. Sunt vagabondul vieții mele, care mânti curaj capul, matură tu de praf de stele, și cu sugiu fără cușul. Iar când dorm spre dimineața, îmi repruzesc de la început. Că nu-mi luat totul de la viața și nu i-am dat cât aș fi vrut. Now, I have to stop there because the second verse is a little bit too. I gotta get the pronunciation a little better, but that's a bad song. I love that song. I had to learn that one.
Yeah, we got one question, Dean. One question. What the hell did you say though?
Love sunt vagabondo vieții mele. I'm a vagabond. It's about this. I'm a vagabond. Sunt vagabondo vieții mele. It's a song about a man who's getting older now. All right. He's been out, and about. He's been doing the girl thing and the one night stand thing, and now he's getting older and he's starting to look back on his life with a little bit of regret, Sunt vagabondo vieții mele. I'm a vagabond, like that. So it's a poignant song, especially coming from me, with the life that I've lived.
Sound very good. Sound good though.
It's
a great song.
Do you and Rick remember a song you used to sing back in the day?
Oh, there's always and forever. There's just the two of us. In fact, I recorded just the two of us on it's on YouTube somewhere. I recorded that with a pianist from Serbia.
So Rick, you still
Rick,
got it?
Rick, what's your favorite song, Rick?
Wow. I don't know if I had a favorite one. It was so many. Whatever was on the charts during that time. I was just watching the show just a few minutes ago, Sam Cooke. So he's one of my favorite, you know. I was watching him on Netflix about an hour ago. So there's so many. You know, we sung whatever.
So can y'all agree to hit a little bit right now, the two of you?
I'm gonna see. I could pull the rabbit out of a hat, disappear and return like that. Cause baby, I'm your magic man. Yes, I am.
You go, Dean.
What was it? Tricks with cards are easy to do, and tricks with hearts can cast a spell on you. Cause baby, I'm your magic man.
All right, let's
go. I'm your magic man. Won't you let my magic hands just touch your heart and make your love appear?
God damn.
You have me crying.
I can't remember all of the lyrics though. Oh God, my goodness. I'm telling my students, I tell all of them, because now these last weeks we've been focused on just a couple of songs, but before that, I was telling them, you come to my class, you must have a book of your songs. Because you'd be surprised how many of the students don't have a book and they just want to try to remember the lyrics. And it's like, no, you have to write these lyrics down in your own handwriting and memorize them to the point that it becomes second nature. I don't want to see this with the phone trying to read the lyrics on Google. I don't want to see that. No, no, no. I want you to step up and be prepared, because that's what it's about. You know, prepare for greatness.
Yeah, I like that. Prepare for greatness. Leslie, you got a song?
I don't. Let me tell y'all. Dean says something wonderful. And Rick, I know you and Dean can relate to this. Remember John Paxson's class talking about important, boring things, the scales. But once you master the scales and repeat it, you was prepared for greatness.
Yes,
so you do the regular things. I love that, Dean. I love it. I love both of y'all singing. I'm going to teach. No, I'm going to get her. I'm going to get you. I'm going to get you. But I love you. And I love for you all. And Rick, you know Rick can sing.
Rick can sing.
Come on, Rick.
Sing. I mean, God.
We had to back in those days. Church. We grew up in church.
Right.
We came from
worship. And we would have worship in our rehearsals.
Let me tell you a story. I remember I was seventh grade, maybe eighth grade. And the first true great basketball player I ever seen in my time was Lowe's. And I remember he would come and pick me up to go to West Virginia. And I had to sing on the ride to West Virginia. That's what I had to contribute to the ride. I wasn't paying for gas or food or nothing.
Right. So I had to sing. You gave your talent.
Let me tell you why. Because there wasn't, but Rick would sing anything, white, black, it don't make no difference. If he come on the radio, he would sing. and anything. You know, but hey, you know, there was only really no black songs on the radio station.
That's right.
West Virginia. Yeah. So then when you get up in the mountains, you're not getting any no radio station anyway.
Reception, yeah.
So we're like, okay, Rick.
You're wrong.
You gotta sing something.
Keep us awake. Man. Yeah, this has been awesome, man. And Dean, I want you to promise me, man, I'm gonna challenge you, right? To get those records.
Yeah.
Those live streams. Man, let us be a blessing to you, man. And
All of you are a blessing to me.
And that
all of you are a blessing to me.
We're gonna get the Italian say, we gotta get, you know.
Donato.
One reunion, you know, we've all been out of school now. I law 40 years. you know, and look how God
she's is throwing doing. Bricks, man. She's throwing bricks at us.
And I'm proud. I'm proud.
I'm already going to get her.
God is blessed. God is blessed. I love y'all. I love y'all.
Yes, love y'all.
Love all of y'all.
Seeing you, Rick and Dean. My God, so good seeing y'all.
Yeah. Our time is up, and I want to thank you, Dean, for standing up. It's 2 o'clock where you are. It's 8:30 where we are. And man, this has been great. Trees, Leslie, Rick, this has been awesome, man. Boys and Girls Club, Mount Vernon High School. This has just been awesome, Dean. And you have blessed. I want you to go get some rest, right? And because you traveled all day to get home. Yeah, and then to come on and stay up and come on the show, it's just been a blessing, man. I was excited. I was excited that Rick said he could come on. I was excited that Leslie said she could come on. And Trees, man, this has just been a great show. Thank you very much for a really blessed night.
And I want to say one thing. Next week, and I know he's going to announce it, but I want to announce it. Next week is his anniversary show. So that is 1 year that the Lowe's
has
been in existence. And it was his dream. Lowe's dream came to reality. And we are 1 year. Next week, we'll be celebrating our anniversary show. So if you have a moment, join us because we're excited about 1 year. Maybe y'all can bring us a new theme song. That'd be good.
You should find a new theme song.
Thank you
for everyone that supports each and every week. You have been a blessing. I'm dropping here's my basketball. I got my basketball down here somewhere. See, that's my pebble in the pond. We expecting the ripple effect from this particular show that somebody's gonna be blessed tonight from watching. So Dean, God bless you. Tell your wife we're sorry for the disturbance. And
same thing, Rick.
Yeah, same thing, Rick.
She's enjoying the show. She's enjoying the show.
Great. Your wife is gonna be saying, "Okay, baby, sing to me now." all right, man. God bless you guys, and have
God bless you guys.
All right, now.
God love you guys.
Guys. Bye. Love you guys.
Bye-bye.
Take good care. Love y'all.
Love y'all. Thanks, Tracy Lowe's.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you, everybody, and see you next week. God bless you.
We really hope you enjoyed this episode of Lowe's More, the Blueprint Podcast. Stay connected and follow us at our website, www.lowesmore.com. That's LowesMore.com. You can also join the discussion on Twitter at Lowe's More and on Facebook at Lowe's More Jr. As always, thank you for pushing your mindset towards a better reality. This concludes the most thought-provoking portion of your day. Don't forget to like and subscribe to this podcast to stay fully up to date with everything we're up to. Until next time, be kind to yourself and each other. What they teaching is a joke. I ain't buying it like I'm broke. Insufficient funds for insignificant.